Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Fall 2013 Social Thought Lecture in Communications. I want to say a few things about the Social Thought program itself, and then we'll introduce our speaker for tonight. The Social Thought program Lecture in Communications began last year as a joint venture between the Penn State Social Thought program and the College of Communications. Since 1992, the Social Thought program at Penn State has served as a network of communication and mutually enhanced scholarship for those members of the university community in various disciplines with shared interests in social, cultural, and political theories. The current faculty social thought program coordinating committee is made up of John Chrisman from philosophy, Greg Agigian from history, Matt Jordan from film, video, and media studies, and the founder of the social thought program, Alan Sika from sociology. The program is also characterized by strong leadership from graduate students, including this year's officers Erica Doloff, Lisa Boyd, Nathaniel Porter, and Brad Server. They would like me to let you know that they've been busy planning the annual spring 2014 Social Thought Program Conference with the theme Knowledge, Power, and Production. The conference will be April 4th and 5th of 2014, and Dr. Andy Abbott, University of Chicago professor and editor of the American Journal of Sociology, will be the keynote speaker. So please keep an eye out for the call for proposals that will probably come out in January. We wish to thank several people who have helped make this lecture series happen. Jeffrey Masco in Communications has helped organize and publicize this year's lecture. Dean Marie Harden has been instrumental in financing the series. Linda Feldman and the Penn State Small Business Development Center have associated this lecture with the Global Entrepreneurship Week. And special thanks to Deborah Cheney, Sharon McCullips, and University Libraries for the use of Foster Auditorium. And now to our speaker for this year. Dr. Brooke Aaron Duffy is an assistant professor in the School of Media and Communication at Temple University, where she also serves on the faculty of Media and Communication Ph.D. program. She has a Ph.D. and M.A. from the Annenberg School for Communication at the University of Pennsylvania. She also has a B.A. from the Department of Advertising and Public Relations here at Penn State, where she graduated as the college marshal. Dr. Mary Beth Oliver was the faculty marshal who accompanied her across the stage that year. Dr. Duffy's research interests include media work and creative labor, gender, feminist studies of media, and critical approaches to advertising and consumer culture. She is the author of Remake, Remodel, Women's Magazines in the Digital Age, to be published by the University of Illinois Press, due out at the end of this month. In fact, she just got a note that the publisher has gotten their first copies. And I can say I've read this book. It's excellent. I think it's going to be a real groundbreaking book to understand how traditional analog media, especially print media, are dealing with, thrown into crisis about, and trying to negotiate the digital era that we're in now. So I think it's, if you're interested in those issues, it will be a fundamental and necessary read. She is also co-editor with Joseph Thoreau of Key Readings in Media Today, Mass Communication in Context, and she has published in such journals as the Communication Review and Communication Culture and Critique, and has nearly two dozen conference presentations. Today, she will be speaking on the romance of work, gender, and aspirational labor in contemporary culture industries. Dr. Duffy.
Thank you. Thank you, Matt. It's truly a pleasure to be back in Happy Valley. When I walked into the Carnegie building this morning, I was reminded that it was the teacher scholars I worked with and the courses I completed in the College of Communications that got me interested in media research and profoundly shaped my research trajectory. And I'm incredibly grateful for the many opportunities today, and I just want to take a moment to thank Matt. So, my time at Penn State did not actually overlap with Matt's tenure, but I had the pleasure of meeting him at my very first academic conference, as I told him last night. And since then, Matt has shown me truly unwavering support, and I'm just incredibly grateful, as I said, for the opportunities including inviting me to present the 2013 Social Thought Program Lecture in Communications. Thank you, Matt. I'm truly honored. I also want to thank the co-sponsors of the event, the College of Communications, the Social Thought Program, as well as the University Libraries. And I also want to thank all of you here tonight. I realize this is a point in the semester that is incredibly hectic, so I do appreciate your time. So as an entree into my current research, I want to share two articles that I recently came across that I think are quite telling of the transformed nature of media work in the aptly named New Economy. The first was published earlier this year in the New Republic's book review section, and it claimed that the 20th century heroines of the, quote, chick lit literary subgenre, those like Carrie Bradshaw, Andy Sachs, and Becky Bloomwood, have been supplanted by a new generation of media mavens. These 21st century protagonists are not hailing from the traditional sites of production. So they're not sitting in bed writing this weekly newspaper column. They're not working in magazine publishing, trying to win the respect of the boss, the Prada-wearing devil. Rather, they are aspiring to rise up the journalistic ranks of the blogosphere as the boundaries between their work and home life seem to fade away, symptomatic of what Melissa Gregg called presence bleed. As the New Republic writer Molly Fisher commented, where chick lit once tantalized readers with romance or fancy clothes, the vicarious thrills of its new media incarnation are much more mundane and much more rooted in the mechanics of actually doing a job. The second article, which was recently published in the New York Times as well as other publications, broke the news that Condé Nast, the publishing behemoth behind such illustrious titles as Vogue, W, and Glamour, was terminating its magazine internship program. And the decision came in the wake of a class action lawsuit which was filed against Condé Nast by two former interns who critiqued them and said in general they were paid below minimum wage despite their investments in time, energy, labor. And if you follow this at all, there's been similar lawsuits filed against both Hearst and Fox Light Pictures. Now, for those who are critical of the exploitative conditions of internship culture and its potential to exacerbate hierarchies of education and class, this signaled a victory. Yet the shuttering of the program drew ire from current college students, as well as former Condé Nast interns, who credited their experience in this program with later successes in the publishing field. And so the stark juxtaposition of these two perspectives really came to the fore in the New York Times article, their coverage of 28-year-old fashion editor Laura Invick. This was how the article began. The 15 pounds frantically lost in the weeks before the interview, the pre-dawn drive from New Hampshire to Times Square, the bed shared with fellow penny-pinching friends near Pennsylvania Station, and the morning and evening walks in heels because she could not afford subway fare. It's so valuable, she said. She also acknowledged that without her parents' financial help, she, quote, absolutely could not have done the internship, which lasted 4 months, and although it was initially unpaid, she did get a stipend, all of $12 a day. So on the surface, these stories might appear kind of dissimilar. One describes a trend in literary fiction. The other is a result of very real political economies of labor. The first one discusses salaried professionals. The other, college students like many of you, who are foregoing monetary compensation in hopes of breaking into this dazzling world of magazine publishing. Yet to me, I think that these stories and these articles can be woven around the symptomatic of gendered forms of cultural production in the early 21st century. And the forms I'm speaking of in general emphasize aspiration and normalize freely provided creative labor as part of a romanticization of creative work. So in my talk this evening, I want to foreground the significance of gender cultures and forms of creative work that are becoming increasingly visible in the digital age. I draw upon my recent interventions into the women's magazine, advertising, and fashion blogging industry to introduce you to what I term aspirational labor. It's a highly gendered, forward-looking, and entrepreneurial enactment of creativity. Aspirational laborers pursue creative activities that hold the promise of social and economic capital. Yet the reward structure for these aspirants is highly uneven. While a select few may realize their professional goals, namely to get paid doing what they love, this system obscures problematic constructions of gender and its intersectionalities with class. And so before I go through and map out some of the salient conditions and features of aspirational labor, I just want to spend a few minutes providing a very brief overview of some of the recent literature on media work and digital labor to highlight this glaring oversight, the lack of explicit engagement with issues of gender. So against the backdrop of widespread popular and academic interest in precarious employment conditions, politically charged debates about free digital labor, and much vaunted industrial discourses of entrepreneurialism and self-branding, media work is quite a sexy topic. Yet this is a somewhat new development in the media studies field. If we take the triad of industry, audience, and text-based studies, the latter two have achieved the lion's share of theoretical and empirical attention. And despite a series of widely published sociologies of news work and entertainment work in the 70s and 80s, the last two decades of the 20th century really saw a movement away from media production research. And this was in part due to the growing prominence of political economy, which encouraged scholars to kind of shift their critical lenses to look at more macro-level power relations embedded in ownership and regulation. And the growing import of cultural studies also figured into the communication field's movement away from media work, away from studying media production. And this is especially true in what Elena Levine aptly described as the cultural studies bias toward analyses of texts and audiences. Now, fortunately, the last few years have witnessed a very exciting revival of media production research. These contemporary interventions into the cultures of media work operate under various names: production of culture, cultural economy, culture industries, creative industries, and so forth. And each of these just namely reflects different disciplinary traditions, as well as their embeddedness in larger institutional and political projects. And what I think is so useful about this work is that together it has helped to shed light on some of the implications for recent transformations in technologies, economies, and markets of production, while also drawing out what media work and what its intersections are with larger transformations, the rise of neoliberalism, precarious economic conditions, and widespread revolutions in global policy and culture. But this recent interest in media work is also a product of digital media theorists who are trying to map out new patterns of productivity that exist in these very fuzzy spaces between production and consumption, between labor and leisure, and between professional and amateurism. And so over the last few years, there's been a medley of half neologisms, among them digital labor, immaterial labor, passionate labor, and playbor, which is a play-labor hybrid, have emerged as scholars attempt to understand new forms of digital and social production. And this work tends to be structured around a key debate about whether user-generated content empowers audiences, or alternatively, whether these initiatives are just thinly veiled efforts to offload productive labor onto us, the unwitting consumer. Now, despite the utility of these concepts in theorizing regimes of governance, labor, and productivity in the new media economy, as I mentioned before, they tend to ally the role of gender. And so indeed, a few years ago, renowned feminist media scholar Angela McRobbie critiqued the gender blindness of researchers studying worker subjectivity in the creative and new media fields. And I would add that today, scholars have yet to really make significant inroads into this area. And I see this as both unfortunate and problematic, given that gender disparities continue to plague almost all of the major media industries. Now, these disparities are not just issues of numbers, how many men versus how many women work in a particular industry. As Carolyn Byerly and Karen Ross productively point out, female media workers confront masculine work cultures, the so-called boys' club, the potential for sexual harassment, and normalization of gendered work practices. Now, meanwhile, the rise of computing and the movement to post-Fordist working practices seem to coincide with new relations about the role of gender in the technology sector. And so there was this idea that flexible work had become synonymous with female emancipation from patriarchal work structures. This idea that by working from home, women can combine their child and home duties, child and work duties. This narrative is problematic in and of itself, and it's been effectively challenged by studies that show, despite the growth of the technology sector, inequalities in terms of gender endure. In her recently published book, Status Update, Alice Marwick explains that the tech scene centers on a myth of the male entrepreneur. As a result, she says, women's contributions to the scene are undervalued, are attributed to men, women are systematically sexualized and judged on appearance, and structural sexism was denied. So clearly there's really a need to put the issue of gender at the center of new media work. My own research of gendered sites of cultural production has led me to identify a class of female content creators who I label aspirational laborers. As I suggested earlier, aspirational labor involves productive activities that participants believe has the potential to pay off in the future, but it also ensures that female content creators remain firmly immersed in the public circulation of commodities. And so, like individuals enacting there are social roles through aspirational consumption. So if I come in here with a Louis Vuitton bag or a Chanel bag, I'm trying to mark myself as a higher class. Aspirational laborers seek to mark themselves as creative producers who will one day be compensated for their craft, either directly or through employment in the culture industries. I see this idea in productive conversation with the notion of hope labor, which was recently developed by two Penn State alumni, Kathleen Kuhn and Thomas Corrigan. They describe hope labor as un- or undercompensated work carried out in the present, often for experience or exposure, in the hope that future employment may follow. And so to Kuhn and Corrigan, hope labor rationalizes neoliberal governance that shifts risks away from corporations and onto individual consumers or producers. So I find this to be an incredibly useful concept for thinking about emergent forms of work in the digital economy. Yet again, I think we really need to remove this gender-neutral lens by foregrounding aspirational labor's reliance on socially constructed notions of gender that are bound up with discourses of authenticity, community, commercialism. The research I'm going to be presenting draws upon 40 interviews I've conducted over the past years with individuals, mostly women though not exclusively, working inside or at the margins of the media, marketing, advertising, and fashion fields. And so this includes research from my forthcoming book on the ways in which women's magazine producers are adapting to digitization and participatory culture, the idea of us, the consumer, contributing content. Also a study I conducted with participants in, it was called the Dove Supreme Cream Oil Body Wash Contest. And essentially this was like the Doritos commercial for the Super Bowl where you submit your commercial and if you win, you go to the Super Bowl. But there was the gendered slant, if you win, you go to the Oscars for this one. And finally, I draw upon my research on the cultures and political economies of fashion blogging. And this involves interviews with producers as well as a multi-year analysis of the Independent Fashion Bloggers Network, the IFB. And this is a resource for individuals interested in learning about photography, content creation, social media marketing, and monetization. And so, you know, this site really allowed me to see these discourses of aspirational labor from the participants. The particular narratives of aspirational laborers take many forms. Some hope that the strategic pursuit of their creative activities will earn them public recognition. A sort of version of Lana Turner's faded discovery at the soda fountain, but updated and repackaged for Web 2.0. So in explaining why she entered Dove's user-generated contest, Kelly told me that, I want to be a director, and this is the third project I've done. I'm hoping to use it for my demo reel to send it out for film festivals. Others, particularly fashion bloggers who are devoting their time to creating content and promoting their sites, they aspire to turn their hobby into a full-time and paying job. For these creative producers, the idea is to quit their day job and get paid doing what they love. And IFB member Amanda explained why you should pursue your venture of love. As the saying goes, love what you do. This couldn't be any more true. People see your passion and they also see when it's absent. It'll show in your efforts, your attitude, and your success. If you start a high-pitched project based on love and passion, everything will fall into place. And finally, there's another group of aspirational laborers that see their creative activities as a launching pad that's going to get them a job in traditional media industries. Fashion blogger Hillary, for example, she's a recent college graduate, and she explained how she was inspired by the success stories of fashion bloggers who have gone from independent status, not working for anyone, to the front row of Fashion Week. And so what Hillary told me is, for somebody who aspires to be the next Anna Wintour, which is Vogue's famed editor-in-chief, that's the dream. Despite these variances in the narratives of aspirational labor, I've identified three salient features of this form of labor, but I can see it going across categories. And as will become apparent as I talk about these, they really overlap and intersect in some interesting ways. Yet I think together they provide a more nuanced understanding of creative activities of female content producers at this present juncture. So I'll start with the authenticity mythos, then talk about the deployment of affective relations, and finally, entrepreneurial brand devotion. So authenticity. Discourses of authenticity and amateurism have flourished over the last decade, set against the backdrop of newly emergent technologies that have ostensibly upended top-down hierarchies and enabled us, again, the consumer, to be active participants in the cultural circuit. We are assured by the culture industries that we, the consumer, are king. At the same time, commercial media and advertising producers continue to deploy these appeals to ordinariness or real people in their campaigns. And there's this uptick in, quote, authenticity advertising that is especially pronounced in the women's market as companies try to align themselves with female empowerment, perhaps more accurately, expressions of commodity feminism. So it's actually been 9 years since the Dove campaign for real beauty has been launched, and since then, companies like Nike, Fila, Marks & Spencer, Jones New York, as well as women's magazines Essentials, Glamour, Marie Claire, have featured women with curves and stretch marks, freckles, gray hair, wrinkles, and other features which earn them the designation as real. As Adweek reporter Emma Bazillion explained of the initiative, so-called real women have been slowly entering the category of professionally glamorous as brands attempt to relate to the woman who is more concerned with balancing her checkbook than maintaining a size zero. Perhaps not surprisingly, the authenticity ideal has provided strong narrative undercurrents for mediated coverage of fashion bloggers. And if you follow discussions of fashion blogging, they often emphasize how they are, quote, democratizing style and, quote, allowing regular Janes like you and me to become part of the international fashion conversation. The rise of fashion blogs that lie outside the conventional Western aesthetic, such as fashion bloggers or Muslim bloggers covering hijab trends, has really amplified these narratives by suggesting anyone can make inroads into the once insular fashion circuit. And I want to play this quick clip that I think nicely captures these ideas of authenticity and how they get applied to bloggers.
The really special voices, the ones that seem to be garnering so much attention, the Brian Boys, the Susie Bubbles, the Tavis of the world, that's because they're saying things in a different way that people find authentic and very personal to those individuals.
A blog doesn't cost anything, so a reader can have several different favorite blogs. You don't have to have one or two magazines that you go buy a month, but just go click on the ones that you like, which is good.
Personally, I think there's actually room for bloggers and stylists and fashion editors and writers alike. I don't think that it should be such a cliquey, closed environment. I think it's absolutely fine. There's definitely room for everybody.
We get the news out faster, so people do kind of look to us to see what the trends are, what people are wearing.
Everyone's putting stuff on straight away. You can be more creative, you've got no restrictions or boundaries.
They give a more personal approach to fashion, you know, when they post, you know, pictures of themselves wearing designer clothes or, you know, outfits. It's really approachable compared to what they see in magazines.
I feel like they're adding a real dose of reality and freshness into the fashion world online.
We've given a lot of limelight to people that otherwise wouldn't have been seen as much, and a lot of editors who are fantastic dressers that no one knew about now are fantastic, and they're leading fashion and they're influencing designers, and that's amazing.
The editors and the styles and the buyers are wearing designer clothes, right? So to see them wear it in their own way, it's a little bit more inspiring.
There's a lot of creative energy and output that you don't get from print journalism, And I think that's actually changing things at the level of design.
I just think they're making a bigger landscape. I think street style blogs are the ones that have really taken off because they're the ones that are in control of all the visual elements, the writing. I mean, it's one visual consistent element.
So for aspirational laborers, this authenticity ideal is a very productive narrative to embrace. And members of the fashion blog community I studied frequently disavowed their expert status by casting themselves as people just like us, or to use British beauty bloggers' cutesy phraseology, not professional journalists, just regular people with a passion for fashion. Vintage fashion blogger Sammy offered me a more in-depth treatment of why it's so valuable to be authentic or relatable. She explained, more and more women are turning to personal blogs for fashion information and turning away from the big dot-coms of magazines. Sammy felt a key limitation of contemporary women's magazines is their nebulous voice. You know, it's very important for women's magazines, magazines in general, to have a strong voice. As Sammy continued, a lot of magazines are struggling because they can't say things that everyone can relate to. They're almost intimidating. People don't want to connect to them. On the other hand, Sammy believed that the strength of fashion and beauty bloggers was the uniquely personal advice they provided, as well as the authenticity that goes alongside it. She assumed that being, quote, 100% authentic and listening to readers rather than metrics was one of the reasons the blogosphere continues to thrive. And several other bloggers I spoke with really seemed to draw upon these themes of realness and ordinariness to establish themselves as those just like us. When I asked Deanie to tell me about her blog, she said, well, I think of it as a beauty lifestyle blog for everyday women. I purposefully try to focus either on products or styling that is actually accessible to everyday women. I don't have a personal trainer and a personal chef, and I don't live this lavish lifestyle. So here, again, she's more like us. She's not the people who are writing the fashion magazines who do have these very lavish lifestyles. Deanie is like us. Similarly, Vonnie's post on the Independent Fashion Bloggers Network really aims to establish her legitimacy as a blogger by actually saying she's not like those who have unique access to the fashion circuit. As she explained, I am neither a professional model nor a professional photographer. I have neither the gritty gloriousness of London nor the grandeur of the River Seine for subterfuge or support. I have no photographer boyfriend, no boxes of goodies arriving at my doorstep. I am not 26 and snapping my way through exams, parties, and fashion design school. Importantly, however, I think these widespread appeals to ordinariness were tempered by evidence that many fashion bloggers do not fit cozily into this idea of real people with a passion for fashion. So first, dispelling claims of amateurism, fashion bloggers both implicitly and explicitly acknowledge their knowledge of or conditioning in the fields of fashion journalism, design, or marketing. And so on the IFB site, you would frequently hear references to my background in art, photography, or fashion, being a writer and designer, being a journalist with more than 10 years experience, and so forth. And participants in the Dove contest I mentioned, several of them also had some kind of experience. Becky, for instance, had even won a few awards for short films and commercials that she produced before the Dove commercial. Perhaps more significantly, the authenticity mythos seems to downplay a basic level of economic capital that is presumably a prerequisite for aspirational laborers hoping to achieve their goal. So I want to use the case of fashion bloggers in particular to make the argument that maybe not everyone can afford to participate in the circuit of production. So first, as the visible enactment of one's personal style, fashion blogs center on clothing, accessories, and beauty products that actually necessitate participation in the consumer marketplace, of course. And now this doesn't apply to street style blogs where people are taking photos of individuals on the street. But all bloggers must have access to the requisite technologies for producing and distributing their content. So photography equipment, the actual blog site and software, and of course wireless internet access to keep them attuned to the fast-paced world of fashion. Yet the IFB site also recommended that bloggers have more extensive technological necessities. DSLR cameras, tripods, remote controls, personalization tools, and editing software, among others. In this respect, blogging actually requires a steady stream of income that is often framed, or at least rationalized, as an investment. As the blogger behind the lingerie ad proselytized, be okay with spending money. Whether it's for purchasing your own domain, signing up for a newsletter service, or attending a blogger conference, the mantra that you have to spend money to make money is true. The injunction to invest in oneself is not unlike those the media sociologist Gina Neff documented in the New York City tech scene as a form of venture labor. It frames individual risk as an investment. However, for fashion bloggers, such endeavors are made all the more important and all the more observable in the context of a field where design, aesthetics, and self-presentation exact a premium. Put simply, blogger investments are made more visual and therefore more visible. Fashion bloggers are also encouraged to engage in networking and professionalization by attending blogger conferences, meetups, even New York Fashion Week, all of which are framed as opportunities to schmooze with fashion designers, media professionals, publicists, and more. And some members of the IFB have even suggested that, you know, you should go out and host your own networking event, you know, put on a little party in your house and invite these people over. These directives to engage in forms of what scholars refer to as compulsory sociality, so necessary networking when work and non-work time bleed, are not available to just anyone. Rather, they require sufficient resources as well as reserves of time and money. Conference registration fees alone, if you looked at these, can be into several hundred dollars. So reflecting on the economic necessity, Deanie said, I think it would benefit me if I went to some of these blogger conferences, but it's just one of these things. It's during the day, and I can't take off from my day job and pay money. It's really kind of nuts. They're kind of expensive, some of these things, and it's just, ugh. So authenticity, then, is less a euphemism for amateurism and perhaps more of a productive myth that enables aspirational laborers to carve out a space at the margins of traditional industries and professions while downplaying their existing social and economic capital. So I now want to turn to the second feature, affective relations. So digital modes of creativity are often framed as individual forms of self-expression. So I'm creating a personal blog because I want to show the world the true me, or I'm joining and submitting this contest submission because I have this creative idea that's very expressive. However, at the same time, the project of the aspirational labor also involves building affective relationships with members of their community. Now, to understand why I'm labeling community practices and discourses gendered, I turn to some of the discussions that I've had with salaried professionals in the women's magazine industry. These individuals revealed how assumptions about gender and, relatedly, consumerism help to guide the architectural landscape of digital spaces. Brennan, for instance, a social media expert with a special interest in publishing, said, "It is well known that the female market is the key to the kingdom in advertising, and women are interested in community." Similarly, one of the top publishing execs I interviewed asserted that she's skeptical about gender-based generalities, but men are much more interested in the gadget and gidget, and women are not. She continued, "We came from a conference in London where you have a lot of brands, and they found it to be true. The women want to be social on the internet." Like these media professionals, aspirational laborers understand that their engagement with social media communities is a critical part of the production process. This is not to dismiss the pro-social benefits of interacting with one's community or members of a like-minded group. Social media participants frequently reflected on the advice, the friendships, the nurturing made possible by their participation in this community. However, aspirational laborers also seem to recognize the instrumental value of their affective relations as they try to grow their followers and friendships and likes and improve their page rankings. For instance, Missy, who was a woman I spoke with about the Dove cream body wash contest, said she turned to the contest community because she thought it could help her improve her creative product. She said, "I could care less about what Dove thinks of me. What's so wonderful is the feedback." Missy thus saw this opportunity to engage with social media participants, again, as a way to improve her knowledge of video production. And certainly one of the central ways in which community is performed and enacted among fashion bloggers is through the provision of feedback, and in particular, providing comments on others' blogs. Yet it's kind of interesting because the discourses of feedback were overlaid with these norms prescribing the nature and extent of commentary. One of the things I found most interesting is blogger commentary was supposed to be authentic, sincere, and genuine, but it also had to be positive. So there was no room for being authentic and negative in these. Perhaps a more pervasive norm was that of reciprocity. Fashion bloggers were urged to give back to the blogging world and support other members of the blogging community. In some instances, this notion of karma was actually invoked to encourage and justify the provision of feedback. And so this here is a quote from Leah, who advised fashion bloggers, "If someone comments on your blog, make time to visit their blog. It's nice to get to know your readers. If you have time, leave them a comment too. You know that warm, fuzzy feeling you get inside when someone leaves you a comment? Rack up some good karma by doing the same for someone else." So by suggesting that bloggers can rack up some good karma from their commenting activities, Leah seems to conflate the emotional experience of receiving feedback, again, this affirmation that someone's paying attention to us, with the potential for future benefits from the blogosphere, namely a kind of give and take commentary. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. Other bloggers were more candid. Go back to this for a minute. Other bloggers were more candid about their strategic plans to garner feedback and providing comments with the explicit expectation that they would be returned. One of the most obvious examples of this was this desire for commentary was a dialogue that took place following the publication of an article called The Comment Challenge. And the Comment Challenge described blogger Amy's personal task of leaving 500 comments a month on other individuals' blogs. And remember, these have to be substantive comments. You can't just write nice posts. When asked to describe her motivation for the challenge, Amy replied she hoped to bring more conversation to the blog community, but also to gain new visitors on her own blog. And it was kind of interesting. In response to this article, many IFB members publicly stated that they would pursue similar challenges, ensuring that their numeric goals would include, again, substantive or meaningful comments. This construction of commenting on other blogs as a personal challenge should not obscure the labor involved in practices of creating and submitting feedback. Bloggers often acknowledge the work of creating a community of value or the hours on the computer connecting with other bloggers. In a series outlining how bloggers could promote their posts, Taylor suggested that post promotion was more laborious than post creation. She said, you know, when I was starting out, it would take me an hour to come up with a good post, but it would take me 2 hours to promote it. Presumably then, these narratives of reciprocity helped to justify considerable investments in the time and energy required to be an effective member of the fashion blogosphere. But not only did bloggers have these guidelines for producing or for providing comment, but also from receiving them, and they were very self-reflexive about what it meant to get comments. Bloggers relied upon these comments along with likes, shares, and other digitally enabled modes of evaluation to, quote, get to know their readers and learn more about their preferences. And the people I spoke with relied upon various metrics, usually Google Analytics, in order to understand their audiences and learn what they liked and what they didn't. So blogger Hillary, for instance, explained that she carefully monitors her metrics in order to craft outfit posts that will appear to her readers. She told me, I use Google Blogspot, and they have really cool analytics. You can look at that and get a sense of what posts have the most traffic. For example, I did a post on layering lessons, and that was probably my most read post. That kind of tells me what I should be doing and what my readers are going to like. And for instance, I've done posts on celebrities. My readers don't like it as much, so I'm probably not going to do that again. My interview with Brittany, a college student majoring in advertising, was also telling of how this emphasis on metrics can shape the creative process. Now, Brittany was not a fashion blogger. She was a Pinterest tastemaker, which essentially means she gets paid to pin things on Pinterest. And the story of how she started doing this is really interesting. She told me that she turned off notifications and had no idea how many followers she had, and then she got a call from a California marketing firm, Hello Society, saying that she had a staggering 3 million plus followers. And Hello Society even markets Brittany today as one of the youngest and most influential tastemakers. Brittany admitted that she pays a lot more attention to her analytics now that she's getting an income from this success. She said, "Now I follow the numbers more closely to see if my numbers are going up or going down and trying to determine what times work best." So she's actually thinking, what time should I post in order to draw the most hits, in order to make my audience happy. She also explained that she has to think carefully about what she pins. You know, she said, "I don't want to overdo certain topics or use too much repetition because people will unfollow." So here there's this concern of unfollowing because, again, this is linked into profitability. Several members of the IFB network also confessed that their concern with growing audiences could even lead to a winnowing of creative activity. Blogger Taylor explained of Google Analytics, she said, "Watching those lines jerk up and down, meticulously agonizing over why one post did better than another, it can drive a girl nuts and totally drain my creative energy." And this tension here between creativity and commerce, creativity and constraint, is very emblematic of work in the creative industries. In addressing some of the work routines in cultural production, David Hesman-Hall and Sarah Barker argue, when creative workers care very greatly about their size of their audience and try to anticipate what audiences might think, there may be a danger of workers losing contact with their own sense of excellence. And so here we see this very, you know, very visibly in traditional sites of media production, creativity versus constraint. But it's interesting that amateur cultural producers are facing similar struggles as they try to think about how to grow their audience. More broadly, this emphasis on quantification suggests how the fashion blogosphere seems to be organized by a hierarchy of social relations where the number of comments, the number of followers you get, is coded as success, or perhaps more accurately, the potential for profitability. And so it's at this nexus of gender, community, and profit-making that provides a necessary backstory for understanding the third and final feature of aspirational labor, entrepreneurial brand devotion. So several years ago, media scholar Allison Hearn described the rise of a distinct form of image-based, individualized, and entrepreneurial labor. She termed it self-branding. The production of the self-brand, Hearn explained, works from the idea that cultural meanings and images drawn from narrative and visual codes of the mainstream culture industries. Perhaps not surprisingly, aspirational labor spend a great deal of time focusing on their self-brand. They understand this is imperative to their creative products. And so just going through the independent fashion blogger's website, aspirants are encouraged to establish a unique digital persona, pitch themselves to marketers, and forge a consistent brand identity across a raft of social media sites. And a lot of times when I was speaking to people about their blogs, they would refer to it as their brand. Yet an important and gendered aspect of the neoliberal self-brand is what I term entrepreneurial brand devotion. This is where digital content creators visibly align themselves with certain commercial brands in hopes of almost riding off their coattails. The term devotion comes from research by my colleague John Campbell, who suggested that online networks for women, and he was studying the iVillage network, encourage the labor of devotion, or the interactive promotion of corporate brands. And the labor of devotion, Campbell explains, capitalizes on advertisers' assumptions that when it comes to the online economy, men loyally consume their favorite brands, whereas women actively promote their favorite brands to other women. Many fashion bloggers, not surprisingly, aspire to work with advertisers. They want to work with brands. Yet they also exhibited concern that they would be accused of, quote, selling out and shunned within the blogging community. So an interesting way that bloggers were able to reconcile this tension between creativity and commerce was by suggesting they were not promoting the brand just for the money. As Mary from Style Files explained, a blogger should only write sponsored posts for products she believes in, products she would write about regardless of the cash flow. It'll still feel honest, and it may even turn out to supplement rather than be a hindrance to the blog. Kate, too, emphasized the importance of believing in the product. Let's face it, we all would like to monetize our blog, so if a company that I love offers a payment or a trade for a post, hell yeah, I would do it. She then clarified, I'm very concerned about the image of my blog, so it has to be something I love. To me, it's never worth the money to promote something I don't believe in. Blogger Dini, who I mentioned earlier, said the same kind of thing. I noticed that she had advertisements on her blog, which suggested she was monetizing it at least at a modest level. And I said, how do you choose which advertisements you're going to put there? And what she said is, I join several programs and I basically choose advertising based on what I want to promote and the blog brands that I enjoy. So this rise of entrepreneurial brand devotion, we can see how it comes from the aspirational laborers, but I've also noticed, perhaps not surprisingly, the marketers and media companies are inviting fans to participate in these highly publicized campaigns. And so the case of the Dove user-generated ad contest that I refer to reveals how participants may perform free work for a company in hopes that they may benefit again off this brand name recognition. Becky, for instance, described the contest as a helpful experience in trying to build her portfolio. Yet she said the reason she chose this particular one was because she thought she could provide recognition for her through the Dove name. Women's magazines, too, are increasingly trying to integrate female audiences in their branded spaces through interactive polls, contests, even initiatives to write for the magazine or appear in the magazine. I don't want to suggest these are necessarily new, but there has been quite an expansion in recent years. And so several years ago, Cosmopolitan launched the Fun Fearless Female User-Generated Ad Campaign, which was a global multi-platform campaign that invited people like us to, quote, be the star of the campaign. And essentially what the campaign involved is you would upload your photo through Facebook, and then you would be taken through this kind of mock photo shoot where almost a blush brush would come out and fix you up, and then you were ready. Your camera photo shoot was ready, and they would simulate your photo shown on Times Square billboards as well as taxi cab screens. And after that, you were encouraged to share this with your friends. And so this reveals how participants were enabled to perform devotional labor on two levels. For one, there was devotion to the Cosmopolitan brand expressly. The act of personally sharing the contest submission is a form of labor, but also visually, through putting your image out there by identifying yourself as a fun, fearless female. Additionally, magazines like Ladies Home Journal, Glamour, and Cosmopolitan have begun to pander to female audiences by explicitly addressing their aspirations to break into the journalism and fashion industries. And so I came across this call, I guess, about 2 weeks ago on Cosmopolitan on Twitter, where Cosmo announced on the social media platforms that you can write for cosmopolitan.com. And again, this isn't necessarily new. Women's magazines have been doing this kind of thing for decades. But it was interesting how they framed it. The web editor explained on the website, after I wrote that if you want to be successful, you have to beg for it and invited inspiring writers to email me and tell me why you should write for Cosmo, you really did. And your notes were wonderful, inspiring, made me feel all warm and fuzzy inside. There's really this emphasis on warm and fuzzy here. What's so fantastic about your letters was that they showed just how ambitious each and every one of you is. They also showed that we're building a community here on cosmopolitan.com that so many amazing people want to be part of, which is web editor is the most gratifying part. So I'm officially inviting you to submit essays for consideration for publication on this very site. And so these efforts encourage laborers to submit stories in hopes of getting discovered or even getting paid. I mean, this contest actually offered people $100, which is more than many of them. But there's a decisive economic logic underpinning these. For one, these activities involve this affective labor where participants eagerly promote Glamour, Cosmo, or whatever the magazine is, through their existing social networks. The value of consumers, though, doesn't only lie in this labor of devotion, but also in providing specific information and creative contributions that can be harnessed by producers and advertisers, particularly among the lucrative young female audience. So to summarize, aspirational labor is a forward-looking, calculated, and entrepreneurial form of creative cultural production that has become increasingly salient in this era of reconfigured circuits of production and consumption. Yet the features of aspirational labor are shot through with nuance and contradiction. The discursive construction of aspirational laborers as authentic was deflated by evidence that bloggers are not necessarily just regular people with a passion for fashion. Rather, some have exclusive access to the cultural circuit and thus draw upon their professional expertise in the areas of fashion, publishing, or digital marketing. Meanwhile, the infectious rhetoric of community that circulates throughout the social media sphere conceals the financial motives underpinning community relations. And finally, through discourses of entrepreneurialism, which are bound up with brand promotion, constructions of consumerism get cloaked in the promise of success, however fleeting it may be. To this end, digital enactments of aspirational labor appear to me at least strikingly similar to the forms of work that we see in traditional media industries. Carefully managed self-promotion, concentrated efforts to know audiences, and the tension between creativity and commerce. These are all tasks and challenges intimately familiar to producers in traditional industries. So does this suggest that the only difference between aspirational laborers and professional media creators is the issue of compensation? Are social media participants cultural dupes blindly doing the work of paid content creators as part of this larger capitalist project that aims to eke out as much free exploited labor as possible? Well, I'm not sure these are the right questions to ask, in part because I believe the benefits accrued by participants, social relationships, creative expressions of themselves, learning and possibilities for real profitability, even just for a few, are much more than shallow returns that effectively feed into the capitalist system. They're real exchanges that convey important social, psychological, and material rewards. But I also think these are the wrong questions because they seem a little bit too steeped in discourses of the new. New media, new forms of community, new career possibilities, and so forth. As a result, I think they deflect attention from some deeply entrenched work realities, including those related to gender and class subjectivities. Indeed, aspirational labor is highly gendered and perpetuates longstanding constructions of gender and hierarchies related to femininity and class relations. For one, the authenticity mythos reaffirms the commercial appeal of real women while productively obscuring forms of social and economic capital that are necessary to pursue this kind of production, networking, and professionalization opportunities. The investments of time, energy, and money exacted of aspirational laborers presumably leaves the playing field quite uneven. Additionally, the emphasis on community and relationship building encourages the strategic deployment of affective relations, but it also reifies the idea that women go to social media to be social. Finally, entrepreneurial brand devotion encourages participants to align themselves with corporate sponsors while serving as unpaid brand ambassadors, and this effectively keeps the content creators immersed in the public circulation of commodities. So in closing, I want to reflect on what the motivations, efforts, and investments of aspirational laborers can teach us about more widespread trends in media work in this unfolding digital economy. Certainly, the ascension of Web 2.0 has foregrounded the glowing clout of creative enthusiasts whose passion and collaborative spirit seems to trump the traditional markers of expertise. Yet a growing number of these amateur creatives believe their reserves of time, energy, and capital will pay off as they get discovered, make a living from their passion products, or even break into a traditional industry. And in some cases, these aspirational activities do pay off. As a quick example, Justine told me that she was trying to get a job in the magazine industry at probably the worst time ever, she said. She decided to be a strong candidate, so she had to have an additional skill set. She started a blog so she could add some digital buzzwords to her resume, and as a result, she thinks this helped her get the job at a well-known women's magazine. Brittany, meanwhile, the college sophomore I mentioned earlier, who was hired as a Pinterest tastemaker, is another example of someone who was able to make a living, or perhaps a part-time job, off her passion project. And finally, the success story of power bloggers like Tavi, Susie Bubble, and Scott Schumann, who used their blogger fame to gain entree into the fashion, photography, and publishing circuits, reaffirms the possibilities of aspirational labor. Yet these tales of achievement should not obscure the practical realities of aspirational work. In the case of fashion blogging, only a few have been able to realize their dreams of going pro. Even those who have actually attracted advertising to their sites and been able to monetize it get very little or, quote, next to nothing. I came across this recent study that suggested that the top 1% of bloggers make $200,000 a year annually, while the rest make $200 annually. So perhaps aspirational labor doesn't pay off if our benchmark is financial compensation. But I think aspirational labor has succeeded in one important way. It has romanticized work in a moment when labor conditions are precarious, unstable, underpaid, all-consuming, and what I would say, unromantic. Thank you. So I'm happy to take questions, comments. Yeah, in the back.
Brooke, I love your presentation.
Thank you. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit maybe about kind of the contrast there? Because so much of what you were saying, I thought, wow, this really applies to the male sports blogosphere. The products are different, right? The brand alignment is different with teams and leagues. This whole idea of the empowerment of the fan, and Bill Simmons, of course, held up as sort of what you can be
if you keep working, yeah.
So can you talk a little bit about more about the gender dynamics?
Sure, absolutely. I don't mean to suggest that women content creators are the only ones doing this. I mean, exactly as you pointed out, TC's work focuses on the same kinds of activities in the sports realm. What I think is so unique about the female content creators are just the discourses and discussions they're having both among themselves on focusing on communities, you know, shopping, these traditionally feminized sites, but at the same time how the marketing communities are constructing them. Again, this idea that, you know, you have to be social to get women. I mean, this has been going on for years. It's the reason that there were so many social shopping sites that sprung up in the early 2000s was based on this idea of women being social. And so I think it's more in terms of the gendered cultures of work rather than men versus women. I mean, there's certainly male fashion bloggers that are undergoing the same kind of things and that are going, I mean, even in terms of the commercialism, that are engaging in these same activities. But I think it's more the discourses of gender that kind of separate these. But yeah, I mean, this is also kind of going on in terms of video game creation. I have a colleague who's studying this, and I think there's so many parallel aspects of this that it's kind of an exciting way to see what's going to happen next. Thanks. Someone, yeah, Kelly.
Actually, what you were saying about like the parallel aspects, when you were talking about the three things like aspirational labor, authenticity, entrepreneurial mindset, the brand, what I think of is as a student in advertising at Penn State, when you're trying to go for internships, or I'm sure maybe understand when you're trying to go for internships or whatever, most of them are unpaid, so totally understand the aspirational labor thing. But also, I'm not sure if any of you have come across the competition and putting yourself out there. And I don't know if it started with the idea of blogging on the internet, but as a student marketing myself to future employers, I'm working on my creative resume. I'm working on my own personal blog to establish myself as a professional in the field. So I feel like that whole idea of aspirational labor, putting yourself out there before you actually get paid for it to be hired, comes back to as young professionals, and maybe it's because of the economy. Maybe it started with people blogging to get attention and stuff, but I don't know. That was a parallel that I thought of when I heard you speak.
And thanks for that. It's really funny because you mentioned that, you know, as a college student, you know, focusing on branding yourself and being entrepreneurial and all of this. But when I was at a conference, and you may have been there, Matt, Mark Doiza, I can never say his name. But so we were talking about all these things as academics, and he said, you know what, we're doing all this. So in our career, we're spending every moment, you know, and I was talking to graduate students today, we'll make sure you have a website, make sure you brand yourself. So, I mean, it's definitely symptomatic of larger trends going on, and I mean, it just seems to be intensifying. And so here, you know, I'm talking about it at the same time, and I'm engaging in the same sorts of techniques. I mean, it's very pervasive. Yeah, thanks for that. Yes?
Do you draw a distinction between the fashion blogging, aspirational labor, and what the student was talking about, where you take an unpaid internship? Like, one seems to be like a side job, and one is very much like a necessity to get a job. So is there like, do you draw a distinction between the two?
My next project, I think I want to start talking to interns, because it is so I mean, just the discussions that followed this Condé Nast thing, I don't know if you followed them, just incredible. There was these widespread debates. And, you know, it's wrapped up in that, you know, the issue of gender, but more specifically class, I mean, that keeps coming up, that who can afford to actually live in New York City and, you know, have their parents pay. So I think it's, I definitely say it's absolutely aspirational. And right now I've just been focusing on the digital lens because that's so new, but I mean, it's just incredible. I don't know if you've read Ross Perlin's book on this. It's called Internation, and it's really interesting, that goes behind the scenes of Disney, for example, and looks at the kind of conditions and what are the more widespread trends that this is doing in terms of rationalizing free labor in this new economy.
But the fashion blogger is still getting, at least, you said moderate compensation. Like, the intern's getting zero, so but you're still putting them as the same type of labor, aspirational labor.
I need to think about how I would separate the two. I mean, that, you know, I've been focusing on the digital component. But there's so much variance. I mean, the $200 is kind of the funny thing. I mean, where does it become work and play? I mean, is it just when you make enough to have a full-time job when it becomes your living? I mean, making $200 isn't enough. You know, I think someone said even for internet access. So when does it actually become enough to support you? Yeah, Michelle. Oh, go ahead.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Brooke, so much. That was such a fantastic talk.
Thank you.
And I have much to talk with you about.
Good. Look forward to that.
About this. But one thing that struck me, too, and that really troubles me, is that all of this, like the internship nation, the aspirational labor, is the disciplining that it does for low-paid work or for that mm-hmm. entry work. Mm-hmm. And it creates a sense, this like a desperate housewife kind of thing, but for workers, right? This desperate worker, and it kind of reminds me, too, of the stories that recur about, you know, people shooting themselves over Nike shoes. It's like, mm-hmm. look at what this commodity culture does to people. It makes people crazy for these important shoes. So let's, you know, I just read an article the other day about them pulling one of the parkas that this is I forget who makes this. I think I read it in the New York Times mm-hmm. or something, but anyway. And it just kind of all sounds to me like creating this army of desperate workers, right? And so that when you get into your first job, you're going to be less likely to say no to how you're also yeah. doing aspirational labor as part of that job to keep your job, right? Working off the clock, taking work home, and having been disciplined by, you know, the free labor that you might have done, hope to do, you're going to be maybe possibly more willing to put up with this other exploitation. So like that just really concerns me. I wonder if you've looked at that kind of like dialectic or
the dynamic larger,
or however you want to look at it, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting. I just started reading Melissa Gregg's book, Works Intimacy.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, the premise of the book is, like I mentioned it earlier, this home life presence fleet. So we're always on, and we start the day going through our emails, not as work, but just because we need to get this done before we can yeah. go into work. And it's exactly where, I mean, it's troubling, and we can see it at all levels, almost at all professions, that, you know, we're kind of taught to feel guilty if we're not working or we're not getting the internship. And, you know, the problem, I think, is just the social inequalities it exacerbates, because there are some people that can't afford to do this, that can afford to work for less or can afford to spend, you know, every waking minute. But that's not the reality for most people. Yeah.
Yeah, I guess this follows up on Steve's question. There's this whole rhetoric and mythos of independence for these bloggers. And they speak affirmatively of having an independent having an authorial voice mm-hmm. as against the facelessness, the lack of voice
yeah.
Of the magazines. If they're offered a job, in other words, if they're offered a job by the magazine, that's what the goal is. So it's a strange, do you think it's a rationalization of underemployment is to celebrate it in terms of independence? Because what they're seeking is dependence.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I think everyone, you know, has to rationalize their choices, and I think the best example of this, where I actually saw someone completely turn. I don't want to give too much details on this. But so I was speaking to this woman who was an independent fashion blogger, and she hadn't done much in terms of monetization. And she really focused on the independence and the authenticity and kind of being able to be my own boss. But she got hired not in a magazine industry, but as one of these affiliate networks where she was affiliated with this program and was getting paid to post certain things. And in our second conversation, that how it changed, and it was a new form of rationalization, which becomes, you know, as I mentioned before, well, I would do it even if I wasn't getting paid. Mm-hmm. So you can see just kind of, you know, the rationalization turning to map onto the activities at the current moment. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What is that show? Sex in the City. But instead, so Gossip Girl is about a blogger, right? It's not just about fashion, but she's blogging about the different lives of the characters in the show. I mean, it's horrible. But I'm just thinking, is there a way in which we could still look at shows, television studies, right, as a way to think of that as also reflecting some of these changes that you're talking about that's going on in the fashion industry with blogging?
Yeah, so I've must admit I've only seen two episodes of Gossip Girl, but yeah, I understand the question where you're coming from. Yeah, I think absolutely, and I talk about this in the book a little bit. You know, there's always this interest in focusing on media industries, the Studio 60 or 30 Rock, going back to the Mary Tyler Moore Show, and glamorize them. And I think there's been such an emphasis on specifically women's magazines, whether it's Devil Wears Prada or 13 Going on 30. That depict these as kind of these, in a way, glamorous, but they also show how hardworking it is. You know, whether, again, Ugly Betty's another example. So it's not just these fun industries. People are actually spending an incredible amount of time working to rise to the ranks. And I think we could see that as kind of a way to show that these industries are not that accessible, that it actually does involve a lot of hard work to get to the top of the ranks. And so that's one way to look at it. And there's, I guess when you mentioned that, it reminded me, I don't know if anyone's seen I think it was a web series called Running in Heels. So I've just seen a little bit, but it was a Marie Claire branded site that focused on, I think, three interns who were literally, like in the first clip, the one who showed running in heels, to go to make the fashion and get it to her boss. And so it's the same kind of thing. It's actually kind of pushing back against the idea that it's glamorous. I mean, it looks awful to be in these positions, but you can see that, you know, they see this as this something that'll pay off, and that's where the whole, you know, feeds into the whole idea of the Condé Nast interns reacting and saying, you know, what are we going to do? How are we going to get a foot in the door if you're completely closing it out? So, I mean, I think it's interesting to kind of look at the two layers of what's actually going on. And then how is media depicting it, but, you know, specifically fictional, I think, are really interesting. That's a good point. Yep.
I find really compelling your description of the kind of neoliberal pedagogy, mm-hmm. entrepreneurialism, and also in relation to this compulsory sociality about sub-branding and connecting that way. I'm wondering if you have found in your research sites of resistance. The question is really, can we say that there's anything like a subculture that resists those forms of compulsory mm-hmm. sociology or entrepreneurial pedagogy mm-hmm. out there related to these topics, or just participating, does that interpolate you into that type of logic?
No, I do see forms of resistance. I mean, that's one of the reasons that I think it's so important to talk to content creators, because I think there's so much, you know, theorizing done and putting them into one or two camps, but until we talk to them. And so I think I have found, I mean, at least micro examples of resistance. I mean, the one I'm thinking of is in terms of the seeing friendships as, you know, quantifying things that are going to lead to advertising dollars. I mean, some people say, I'm not going to feed into this system. I am not going to spend time going and commenting on other people's just so they're going to return to me. You know, I actually like these friendships. And, you know, we hang out outside and it has nothing to do with work. So I think there are some spaces for resistance. But I think it's hard because there is this, you know, I think Kelly mentioned this competitive mindset that, well, if everyone else is going to the conference, I have to go to the conference. And I mean, I was looking up some of the fees. I'm like, I wanted to go for research, and they're really incredible, the fees, and they come up all the time, and people get so excited to go to these events. But you know, it's kind of, if you don't, you're excluded. But so I think there is like the failure to go against the grain, but I do see small spaces, if that makes sense.
To the extent that they really emphasize their experience in fashion and photography and journalism, and they invest in the fancy camera equipment and all of that. So now it's almost to the point where, like, there are no amateur fashion blogs. Like, they look professional, and they actually kind of are professional. And now it's really difficult to enter that field as a true amateur. Like, someone, you know, a high schooler sitting at home can't just go start her own fashion blog, basically. They raised the bar so high. So I'm wondering if you see like some other opening for actual like true amateur aspirational labor. I don't know if you've noticed anything like that that's kind of opening up, since I feel like the fashion blog field is sort of a little too professionalized.
Yeah, I mean that's an interesting comment on two levels. I mean, the first is the idea that it's a little too professional. I mean, that's what everyone is saying, that if you didn't jump on the fashion blogging bandwagon in 2007, 2008, you're kind of beyond, because it is turning very much into an industry. But I think the other thing that's kind of interesting is this idea of amateurism has become very marketable. And, you know, so you see the professionals trying to pretend and mock these amateur aesthetics in hopes of making that sellable, I would say. So I don't know how to get through. I mean, it's just like a viral video. What's the trick? And I don't think anyone actually knows what the trick is. But I see these kind of, you know, the professionals and amateurs almost copying each other and seeing, you know, who's ahead in one sense. Yeah.
Thank you for your talk, Brooke. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the women that you interviewed, and particularly where blogging fits into their lives in relation to maybe other, are they doing other types of work that they are getting paid for? I'm particularly curious as to whether you observed any differences in terms of their attitudes towards these ideals that you mentioned, depending upon where they are in their lives. I mean, you mentioned that the one woman, you know, felt like she couldn't, you know, make the commitment to go to a conference, and, you know, what were some of the trends that you observed, and did they relate to maybe what was the woman's everyday pattern and life and rhythm?
Yeah, I mean, there was definitely a sense of, and again, I think this very much applies to those of us who are academics, but this guilt if they were not spending as much time as possible improving their blog. And this goes for people who were getting paid, but also who weren't getting paid, because again, it's the aspiration that someday it's going to get discovered. And people would talk about just, you know, coming home from work and spending hours and hours and hours, and then there was, again, the resistors who said, I mean, this is crazy. You know, I do this because it's fun. There's absolutely no way that I can spend as many hours as possible doing this just to keep up. So, I mean, there's variance in the amount of time, but I think the thing that wove them together was this emphasis on, well, I always should be doing more. And, you know, it was interesting to see, again, this difference between post-creation and post-promotion. And it really seemed to you know, shift in favor of the latter, where people spoke about, okay, well, I need to, you know, spend as much time as possible commenting on other blogs, but I also need to make sure Twitter is updated and make sure as soon as I post something, it goes on the Facebook feed at the right time, but I don't want to annoy people. And so it was, you know, this strategic plan of how to get these out that'll be most effective. But even this is just, you know, it's all consuming if you're thinking so strategically about something that, you know, for some people, at least we think, started as a creative activity that you did because you loved it. It was your hobby. And, you know, it's right there that it becomes so strategic that I think for a lot of people, you know, perhaps the fun is removed. And, you know, specifically the one woman, when the people were talking about the metrics, I mean, it was almost kind of sad to see them, you know, focusing so much on metrics that you could almost tell that they're losing, you know, that sense of their own excellence, because, you know, the minute you stop paying attention to what you want to do and so much what the audience is, what happens from there? Yeah, Jeffy.
I have a couple of questions. One concerns what seems to be a bit of a contradiction between the idea of community and yet this competitive nature.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder more how that's articulated. You talked about how the community is kind of performed in some senses, but I wonder how the competition, you know, this idea that I'm, you know, if, you know, X magazine picks, you know, X blogger up, that means I'm not getting picked. You know, so there's definitely that competition. And the other thing that I was wondering, you know, it seems people suggest that a lot of traditional news journalism has been somewhat undermined by kind of citizen journalism.
Yeah.
And the shrinking of, you know, news bureaus and stuff. Is this kind of like structuring happening in the fashion world? I mean, you said it's almost a new industry. Is this displacing in some senses the old one? And in the sense that the business structure can say, oh, look, we have this free labor. Maybe we don't have to pay some of these other folks as much. Or are they kind of parallel industries or the amateur professional? And I know that this is kind of, they're imbricated, you know, really now, but.
I think there was definitely the same kind of things that are happening in all industries, whether news and entertainment, in terms of having, you know, the tension seems to be focused on the magazines versus the bloggers. And I think, again, it's this, they emphasize authenticity because it becomes a way for brands to cling to these people. I mean, now we're seeing fashion bloggers, you know, representing as brand ambassadors. So that's kind of interesting. But I also think, this idea that magazines and bloggers are competing and they're totally separate is very productive for both of them. I think, like I said, in a lot of ways, they're doing the same sorts of things. But I think there's been, and there's a really neat article written on this, I believe her last name is Roca Mora, but that actually, in a lot of ways, they're working with each other. And so in the past few years, you've seen the incorporation of fashion bloggers into the women's magazines. And I think what this does in some ways is it tends to reaffirm the distinction that the ultimate goal is to get in these industries. And what was your first question?
In the competition within this kind of discourse of community?
Yeah, I mean, there was, yeah, it was a very palpable tension because in one sense, you hear this emphasis on community, and they, you know, one of the quotes I liked was, you know, we should pretend that we're all part of one big corporation called the blogosphere, and there's more than enough power and profitability to go around. I mean, it was taken from a blogging book, and that was fantastic. But there was very real hierarchies, and not just hierarchies in terms of competition, but they had labels. So there's things like they called the mid-tier blogger, or the top-tier blogger, or the newbie blogger. That it, you know, it's interesting to see these two ideas of community and democratization versus this very hierarchical coexisting in the same space. And you know, the place where it gets called out is those that say, you know, I'm not participating in the system. I am not going to spend all this time getting 3,000 followers to get advertisers, because it is very much financially incentivized. Different affiliate networks and advertisers will only work with people if you have a certain number of followers. So it's actually, you need a baseline of whatever, 3,000 followers or 4,000 followers, 10,000 in order to partner with one of these. So it's, you know, it becomes this thing, we need to rack up as many as possible, just like, you know, just like TV producers who are trying to get their ratings up. Yeah, thanks.
I didn't mean to rush things, but any more questions? We have time for one more, maybe?
Mm-hmm. Followers. But if you have looked at what these advertisers are looking for, there are certain trends that kind of mirror or mimic the trend from, you know, more animal mediums?
Yeah, I mean, I think in a sense it depends on the advertiser, but I think it's just the idea of getting someone who is seen as ahead of the curve. And so the Pinterest tastemaker, you know, I was talking to her a little bit about, you know, what the identity was of her Pinterest site, and she said that she was a little bit quirky, and she was one of the first people that she had, you know, traditionally feminine posts, but she also had a lot of tattoos, and she thinks that's what kind of set her apart from the others, that she was able to have, you know, kind of get two very different audiences. But it's just, you know, magic of her getting this kind of followership. But I think also advertisers are looking for people that can really play up this idea of authenticity. I mean, a few years, I think it was American Apparel, they were looking for bloggers to sponsor, and they, who is this, you know, we need someone who is authentic and is being the real you, and you know, showcasing your crazy style and how this doesn't fit into the convention. Okay, well, this person looks great, let's partner with them. But yeah, I mean, I'd love to look at the trade press and see how they're discussing these. I think that'd be really interesting.
All right, well, please join me in thanking
Dr. Thank you.
Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you.